During the interwar years, the future commanders of the German panzer armies led a strange existence. Respectable professional soldiers like Heinz Guderian were reduced to working in secret. The Treaty of Versailles had totally prohibited the use of tanks in the German army. But with the help of Soviet Russia and the covert assistance of a small team of engineering specialists using disguised agricultural equipment, Guderian and his colleagues managed to keep pace with developments in tank warfare. Despite the difficult conditions, they even managed to develop some new innovations of their own. They could see the advantages that the tank could bring to the next war, and they developed new theories that centered on the use of the tank, theories that would revolutionize the way wars would be fought. Despite the problems of convincing his superiors of the advantages of the tank, Guderian in particular stuck to his secretive task. With determined persistence and the help of some impressive demonstration exercises, he convinced both the German General Staff and Adolf Hitler that the tank could help to win future wars.
I'm standing here in Bovington Tank Museum in front of the Panzer I, which was one of the mainstays of the Panzer Force in 1939. This is a command version, so it's actually slightly higher than the normal Panzer I. But as you can see, it's not the great juggernaut of legend. It's a very small machine. In many respects, it's not much larger than say, a modern Land Rover. But there were probably 1,500 of these in service in 1939 and in 1940, because there was no alternative.
There's no denying that a tank like the Panzer II is a lightweight. The gun, 20mm cannon, wouldn't really do anyone any serious harm. Armour thickness is not particularly brilliant. It's probably as good an example of any of the fact that it's often how a tank is used, or how armour is used collectively, that is far more important than the actual might of the gun or the thickness of the armour.
As a result of Guderian's efforts, in 1935 the first panzer divisions were formed.
Every arm had to be presented in the panzer division to make the panzer division almost a small army in its own right, not to depend on anybody else.
These formations included a tank brigade with 560 tanks to provide the main firepower. The tank brigade was comprised of two tank regiments, each of which was split in turn into two battalions. Two motorized infantry regiments provided close support to the tanks. A reconnaissance battalion was added to scout out enemy positions and seize weak points. A motorized artillery battalion with 48 guns provided artillery support. To provide defense against enemy tanks, an anti-tank battalion was also added. To back up all of this, the division had its own full supply, support and repair system.
Guderian realized that tanks and armored warfare were going to be the future, that hard-hitting, fast-moving spearheads of tanks, accompanied with infantry and artillery and all the other arms of service, would pack a formidable punch.
You can really trace this back to two events that took place up on Salisbury Plain in 1928 and 29, which were basically an attempt to test out the armoured warfare theory. What actually happened was that a unit known as the Experimental Armoured Force was created, and this armoured force consisted of tank battalions, light tanks for reconnaissance, infantry machine gun carriers, armoured cars for scouting, self-propelled artillery, mechanised engineers in trucks, and even the infantry carried in half tracks, and all supported by the Royal Air Force. And what you ended up with was a small, highly mobile, very, very strong fighting force. Now, in these exercises on the plain, they were pitted against a conventional infantry, mounted cavalry, horse-drawn artillery division, which was huge by comparison. In every single operation, no matter how the umpires cheated, and they did cheat to try and give the traditional arms just a bit of moral support, the armoured element won every single action. And the proof was there, and the effect it had was amazing. Because in Britain, one or two stuffy old officers actually began to talk about tanks as if they might have a future. The people who took notice and the people who learned were the Germans. They could see that if a highly mobile striking force could be created, not just tanks, not tanks alone, you need intimate artillery support, you need preferably armoured infantry keeping up with you, you need everybody mobile in a package, and you need equally immediate air support, hence the Stukas and that kind of thing. And this sort of force sent against a conventional army would go through it like a hot knife through butter.
The heavy tanks would be used as the spearhead to actually punch a hole through the enemy lines, and the lighter tanks would be used on the flanks to actually protect them against infantry and artillery attack and maybe other tanks. But the heavy tanks would be used primarily to push the way through and to keep going and to open the gap in the enemy defences.
A great deal of accurate thought had gone into the development of this type of formation. The resulting Panzer Division was a well-balanced force which could call on the support of any or all of the component parts to capture an objective. The purpose of this organization was to launch a speedy advance deep into enemy territory and keep going, spreading confusion, fear, and panic in the enemy command and communication systems. One further innovation was the close links with the Luftwaffe, which could add even more firepower when needed.
The Luftwaffe and the Panzer divisions had intimate links in terms of Luftwaffe staff liaison officers who actually travelled on the ground with the Panzer divisions. This meant that at any time, whenever a Panzer division came up against any particular trouble where it might need air support, there were already radio communications established with the Luftwaffe, which meant that the taxi ranks of Stukas and other Luftwaffe bombers could be called into play very, very quickly. And this flexibility and again the rapidity of the calling up of air support was vital and indeed an intimate part of German Blitzkrieg.
The training given to these new Panzer warriors emphasized speed and independence of thought. When these units were unleashed, they offered a very effective weapon that their enemies found impossible to master. In Poland, this new force had the first opportunity to put their meticulous training into practice. The Polish campaign was a triumph for the Wehrmacht and showed the potential for the tank in battle. Nonetheless, some problems were encountered.
Because events had moved on far quicker than Hitler would have liked, they had to press these things into service. They were used in the Polish campaign where their weaknesses were very apparent. And certainly by the time of France, it was obvious that these machines had to be retired. Interestingly, they were kept in service right through to 1941 and even later, because it was simply not possible to produce enough machines in enough quantity to bring them onto the battlefield in the kind of time we're looking for.
On the 10th of May 1940, the tide of Hitler's conquest turned to the west. This time the Germans will be fighting more modern armies that were equipped with at least equal or sometimes superior equipment. The Maginot Line that stretched along the majority of the French border to the east was bypassed when German panzers advanced through the Ardennes region in Belgium. By a combination of careful planning, surprise, and some very daring new innovations, the Germans were able to make these fortifications almost obsolete. Once passed here, they advanced all the way to the coast with little in their way to stop them. What had proved impossible in 4 years of trench warfare during World War I was accomplished in the space of 6 weeks. The value of the tank in modern warfare was well and truly established. The tanks that helped win these early victories and create a new legend in